Sub Club. So you remember the other day I mentioned Sub Club of the, you know, wrangling donations together in order to pay for, no, yeah, Sub Club are raising money so that they wouldn't close, right? They're trying to raise some money to allow them to stay open until December when they hope things will get back to normal, so they can resume their club reopening and, you know, whatever programming schedule. And I thought it was an important, you know, thing to kind of highlight. Of course, Sub Club, I've never been there, but I've heard a lot of great stories about it being an institution in the Glasgow scene, it being one of, you know, only a small number of nightclubs that we have in the UK that kind of attracts a worldwide audience, a worldwide DJ roster of artists that perform there, just have generally got a good reputation, you know, legendary sets from Optimo and the like. So it's got a good, you know, good sentiment towards it, and guessing by how quickly they raised donations over a period of, let's say, a week or whatever, it kind of felt as if, yeah, this is something good to kind of, you know, back. Then out of nowhere, Techno Twitter, right, came out of nowhere, out of the blue, and sort of raised up some very interesting amendments that need to be placed alongside this Sub Club raising up donations, and just questions that need to be sort of like answered in it as to what's actually really going on. And this is basically it. I kind of noticed it first from this Twitter account on Twitter that said the following. That said this. I said, if I was a director of Sub Club moaning about not being able to access the furlough scheme and appealing to public donations, I'll probably not film my Insta feed with pics of me on a private jets or be one of the highest to one of Scotland's biggest fortune, which is really weird, isn't it, right? So one of the people involved in Sub Club essentially being accused of having exorbitant amounts of wealth that doesn't really allow them the opportunity to sort of plead for the public to assist them, which is something that's been happening often. I'm trying to figure it out. I'm meaning to kind of research it myself, but if anyone knows why this is happening, please leave me a comment down below. It's been a common occurrence during COVID-19, coronavirus lockdown. There's been a few government initiatives such as the paycheck protection scheme or something. Everyone's got something, right? Every country has some sort of thing in place that companies can apply for. In the UK, we have a furlough system where companies can apply for a grant that allows them to cover up to, let's say, 80% of wages under a certain amount, blah blah blah, so that the companies don't need to let go of people for the interim, so that they can give themselves the opportunity to kind of come out of this from the other side and be able to kind of resume some sort of business and get money in that way. But there's also been a prevalence of really big corporations who have been applying for this government grants of protection when some people would argue their founders or the amount of wealth of cash that they've accumulated over the years should allow them to be put in a position where they can kind of fund it themselves, but they would rather take the money from the government and fund it themselves. What I'm interested in is, why would a company apply for a pay protection scheme or for a furlough knowing the amount of public backlash they're going to get? Like, especially with everybody being an activist or a social justice warrior nowadays, with everybody being in lockdown and being on their phones, people are very much in tune with what's happening in society, right? People are trying to kind of put their best foot forward. They're trying to contribute. They're really game to sort of like take down big corporations. Why would you put yourself in that crosshair? Why wouldn't you just sort of like, you know, back away from the furlough system, back away from the furlough scheme? I think even Liverpool did one of the, you know, a club that sort of won the Premier League here in the UK, applied for the furlough scheme, and then they kind of, you know, essentially backtracked from it. Liverpool, Tottenham did the same thing as well. But I'm just wondering, why would the company put themselves through that? Like, or are you just hoping you kind of like slip through the cracks? Anyway, so that's happened. Sub Club have obviously got a wealthy benefactor, a wealthy supporter or patron. So it would kind of make you think, if that was the case, I need to raise money, why couldn't they just, especially because the amount was, you know, I don't think it's right to judge, you know, people's donations and stuff, but the amount was only 90,000 that Sub Club were asking for, right, in order to kind of allow them to sort of see themselves out until December. So you'd imagine some of their board of directors or their investors could be able to kind of pull that money together and keep the club afloat, instead of kind of asking the public, most of which are, you know, out of work or have diminishing finances, to dip into their pockets to support the club. It's a bit fishy, isn't it? It continues. This is the next tweet in the thread. It says, yesterday, partying in Berlin with Peggy Goo and John Paulson, having flown down a private jet. Today, please support our crowdfunder for the music. Cushy is a director of Sub Club, Trespass Clothing Firm. His family net worth is 90 million. Sunday Times Rich List 2017. And obviously, the optics are horrible. This kind of reminds me of, you know, when you like call in sick for work and then you forget and you post something on Instagram stories, or you post like something about you going out or whatever, right? It's just that common thing that you know, right? If you're going to call in sick after having a bit of a heavy one the previous night, the best thing to do is sort of like keep yourself on social media. And I imagine if you're somebody that's of some sort of high net worth and you're involved in some kind of public plea for donations, it's probably a good idea not to boast about you taking a private jet to go visit your good friend Peggy Goo in Berlin. And isn't it just funny as well that, you know, with all these issues that happen in techno, Peggy Goo always seems to sort of like rear her head. She always seems to be involved. There's always the mention of her. And I guess maybe it's because she's one of the more successful ones in techno, right? She's essentially had a very expedient growth, expedient sort of success, depending on how you look at her career. Some people would argue, you know, this is where she should be. Some people argue she got there too quickly. Wherever it may be, whenever anything happens concerning money, concerning privilege, whatever it may be, she seems to always be involved in the conversation. But part of me thinks she doesn't get it must be difficult for people online that criticize a lot of people in techno, rightly, who kind of are a bit, you know, suspect in how they go on, because she's a woman, right? A young female at that. Not self-made entirely, but for the most part, you know, she's had to kind of, you know, navigate the scene without having many co-signs, right? I'd assume, right? Except for her being, I don't know, would you say that she has a co-sign? Does that how it's work? Because usually in DJing, there's always somebody that sort of like brings you in under their wing, right? You kind of get mentored. But I can't really remember who Peggy Goo was associated with as a mentor. She kind of just came in as a sort of fashion influencer kind of girl and sort of like pivoted into the actual dance music scene. I don't know, maybe that's the way I'm looking at bad optics. But regardless, it must be really difficult for people that criticize DJs on Twitter to sort of level the same amount of criticism at Peggy Goo, because she's a woman and there's not many women in techno or in dance music in general, or in DJing world in general, of that level of success. So you're not really trying to be that person kind of hating on her, because there's not many of those people around. You want her to be an example. But then she's so, as with most industries, right, the people at the top, there is the amount of opportunities and access that they have is so disproportionate to everybody else, it just pales in comparison. So she gets so many chances and opportunities to add to her, you know, incredible levels of finances, incredible levels of success, that it, you can't help but think that people that are looking from the outside in, who are critical of DJs, are like, god damn it, man, like, can't we get a chance to do something? You know what I mean? But it must be difficult, because you can't really criticize her, because optically, you know, she's a woman, she's an Asian lady at that, so she's a minority, she ticks those boxes, and for the most part she does come across rather safe. Now again, I don't know the woman, never spoken to her a day in my life, don't know anything else about her apart from a couple of interviews I read online, but she seems pretty cool. She tends to keep her nose out of trouble. She generally means well by the stuff that she does. And she can't help it that she happens to be one of the people that, you know, happened to Seth Troxler. You get ordained as the one, and then everyone sort of like hyper scrutinizes you. But it's not your fault. You didn't ask to be ordained as the one. The scene just chooses people sometimes. Sometimes, it's, you know, there's some skullduggery involved. But it is what it is. You just got to ride that wave when you can ride. And when it's over for you, right? So yeah, it's just interesting that she always seems to be in the picture when this stuff's happening. Like, people are essentially sacrificing the future of their nightclub, right, in terms of reputation, to take a private jet to go and visit her in Berlin. Like, she has some clout, right? She has some bloody pull. People are like really desperate to be. And again, I can't remember a DJ in the scene who had this level of, who was this divisive, right? Like, the people that love her hard, isn't it? They have that kind of like, was it Peggy fucking Goo t-shirts, and they're all coming to the concerts with like inflatable animals and stuff and blowing her kisses and giving up. She's selling merch. Like, she has a really rabid fan base, right? And even interesting, more so, she has a lot of Korean fans, because sometimes, you know, people sometimes, like herself, I'd imagine people from immigrant families usually have to find success outside their country before they get recognized inside their country. But she seems to have a very kind of loyal fan base in Korea too, which is a great win for her. But then her detractors, the people that don't like her, like, they hate her guts. That's so interesting, isn't it, to see? And again, I'm not really sure I've seen a character such as her in techno or in dance music for a while. You can maybe say someone like, I don't know, like a David Guetta, but he's not really in our scene, innit? And you know, again, people don't really give a shit, right? If you don't really like his music, he just carries on doing what he does. But I can't really think of anyone else in the scene that's that divisive. Interesting, innit? And look at this guy. He's going all the way to flipping Berlin to go to her birthday on a private jet, if that. And then the next tweet is him saying, "Our beloved sub club is in real danger, closing down. 33 years of changing lives for the music, by the music. Please support if you can and share and raise awareness." It's just really odd. And again, I wonder what's happening there. Like, why would somebody that clearly has the funds to lift up his own club himself be clearly, because I guess in some respects, if he would have come out and said, "Hey, I'm supporting the nightclub, I'm keeping them afloat, but we're going to raise donations that's all going to go entirely to our staff so we can make sure we cover our staff members, you know, from the door guy to the person in the cloakroom to the bartenders, bar backs, just support us so that we can support those people until the end of the year, right? I'm going to pay for the maintenance of the club, make sure the rent's covered, all that sort of stuff, right? The actual, you know, big bucks of an institution like that, I'd imagine, because it must cost a lot to keep a club like that running with no people inside it. That would be okay, innit? Would that be pretty fine? I'm guessing most people would want the rich persons to do everything, but if there was some kind of compromise where he can sort of cover the cost of the club and then ask for donations for the people that work there, that would be fine, because, you know, the understanding would be that, you know, if that is such an institution, people should have an affinity towards the people that work there and want to put some money in. But at the moment, man, like, it's such a weird thing to do optically wise. Like, why would you do that? Especially considering how quickly the actual fundraiser got covered and all that sort of stuff. It just feels like a real big misstep. Like, they effed it up for no apparent reason. And again, it's just interesting to see that Peggy Gou seems to always be involved in these sort of issues. But yeah, that got said, and then I guess the guy sort of came back out and defended himself somewhat by saying the following. Get up on here for you to see. He responded the other day with a little statement on Twitter. Hopefully he hasn't deleted it. Yep, here it is, a little note. He said, this is from the guy called how do you pronounce his name? Yusik Hushi or Yusik Kushi, I don't know how you pronounce it, but regardless, it says the following. A note, UCX, it says the following. I went to make a personal statement to clear a few things up today following the Subby crowdfund to stop anything taking the shine off what was an amazing effort that everyone at the club and all those who have generously donated so far. I took a minority stake in the sub club last year because it became available out of the need for support and funding which I could provide at that time. Okay, all things are good there. He says, I never made a penny out of the sub club and never will. I'll only put money in. Great, sounds like a good guy. He continues, I don't have any day-to-day involvement other than as an unpaid advisor to Mike and Barry, who run the club and are pulling together Herculean effort to ensure it comes out at the other end of the crisis. Cool, that's a perfectly good sentiment. He continues here, it says, my work at Subby is purely out of the love for the Glasgow institution that deserves to be protected, and behind the scenes I do my best to help. With regards to the crowdfund, I donated personally as soon as it was launched and reached out to many of my contacts. Again, that's the issue, isn't it? I wonder why rich people that have that amount of let wealth, why are rich people that greedy? That's an interesting question. I guess if you're rich, the only way to keep that kind of wealth is to kind of watch your P's and Q's. You can't be willy-nilly throwing money around, innit, like your Father Christmas. That's just not going to work. You have to have some level of selfishness to you, I guess. I understood. But if you're in the scene, right, and you're about save our scene, and you're kind of talking about how important this club is to the local community, all this sort of garbage, you would want to maybe set an example, maybe restore the feeling, quote unquote, right? And maybe just supporting it out of your own pocket would be good, even if it means you sort of like being really yucky and putting yourself front and center and saying that you saved the sub club. That would, you know, it probably would leave a bad taste in their mouth, but people would get it. But I wonder why he was so resistant again, because I remember the original goal for sub club was $90,000, right? £90,000, which, again, you know, no one's judging anyone's pockets, no one's, you know, I'm not trying to calculate how much money he has, but if you're, you know, assumed worth in your family is 90 mil and you're able to charter a plane to go to Berlin, even if it's not a private plane, it's a plane that you maybe hire for the day to go to Berlin to go visit your friend. I don't know, man. I don't know. The optics don't look great there, do they? It continues with regards to the crowdfund. I donate personally as soon as it launched, and I reached out to many of my contacts from various walks of life to join me in donating if they could afford to do so. I also proudly support many of the other Glasgow clubs and venues, independent promoters. So basically he's saying, hey, I donated what I could. I'm not going to give any more. Plus, I donate to other clubs around, which I don't talk about. If you want more money, suck my toe. That's basically what he's saying, isn't it? He continues. He says, I was a guest on a trip to Berlin last weekend where we traveled on a private plane and I shared this image on Instagram. I don't own a plane and I didn't charter one personally, but in it doesn't matter really, isn't it? But in hindsight, I can understand why these tweets are taken apart, why those these posts taken together out of context have confused, has caused some confusion and are insensitive, which I regret. Not really. No one's really, I guess no one really cares if you go visit your friend in Berlin. Right, people are just wondering why somebody that's worth an alleged £90 million family worth, regardless, right? But you know, you have some kind of level of wealth to your name, why you would want to crowdfund a bar you're part of that's only asking for 19,000. We're not talking about buyers asking for, imagine, because a lot of rich people might not have the ability to get £1,000 cash in their hands, right? Liquid, right? They might not have that liquid asset to kind of invest in anything. They might have things tied up in places, money coming in from rent, but they don't have that money in their account. That's understandable. But to say that he doesn't have 90,000 that he could sort of pull from his friends or, you know, whatever it may be, or from the fund that he put together for the club, it's a bit weird, isn't it? Very strange. It makes you wonder where the actual 90,000 is actually going to the club in the first place. And then it continues and says, and then the main priority right now is the sub club and the people that work in it and the people who love it. It is a special place, so many, and Mike and Barry's campaign has really highlighted just how important it is in Glasgow and in the music industry. I'm proud to have played a small part in it and will continue to help in any way I can. That's the issue though, isn't it, really? You shouldn't have, I guess if he wasn't associated with the nightclub, no one would care. He's actually causing more harm than good, so it probably would have been beneficial from at the end just to be like, hey, I understand what's going on, I'm not in a position to help out in any more in that way, and I understand my presence is probably doing more damage than good. I'm gonna bow out, because it seemed like people had a lot of good feelings towards Sub Club, without even, because I didn't know this guy even existed, right? So people had a lot of good feelings about the club and when to support it, so it probably is beneficial from just to step aside and sort of allow him to do it, because obviously he doesn't want to put any more money in, because maybe he can sit there and say, hey, I put in more than 100,000 in just over a year, right? Which is a lot already, right? So I don't want to put in more money, especially with the climate changing, and he doesn't know what the thing will be, what the world's going to be like when everything does reopen later in the year. I understand, it's your money, do your thing, but it is taking a little bit away of the shine of what's going on, the kind of organic sort of crowdfunding initiative that happened with the Kickstarter, with the crowdfunding initiative or campaign that's put together. And again, it's just disappointing in that regard, like disappointing somebody of his stature wouldn't want to put in any more money, and why they'd kind of try and explain it. It's also funny that Peggy Goo's also involved, right? Just weirdly enough, she's just associated with this. It's just bizarre, isn't it? Like, she ends anything concerning money, anything concerning, yeah, money in the scene, she ends up to always being tangled in it some way or the other, and she always seems to come out of it the other side as well, really spotless. But bloody hell, man, what a funny situation. But hope it gets sorted out sooner rather than later for all.